So, I apologize. Okay. All right.
Okay, so this week, last week we did talk about the Beatitudes. We talked about, we began with talking about Matthew's accounts, and then we compared it to Luke's Sermon on the Plain and his Beatitudes, which we said Matthew takes 3 chapters to do and Luke takes 30 verses, right? So, and it's interesting because Luke is actually the more wordy of the two. Yet for this, it does less. So, all right. So we're going to pick up and we're going to pick up with Matthew. And we talked about Frederick Bruner uses in his commentary on Matthew, he calls the 2 verses that we ended with yesterday, or last Sunday, he calls those the you are's of Jesus' Sermon on the Mount. It says, you are the salt of the world. You are the light of the world. All right. So we ended with those last week. We're going to move on to what Bruner calls the commands and what Luke calls the woes. So Luke is going to take, he's going to take his Beatitudes and then he's going to reverse them. And he's going to talk to us about how, so he basically reverses the Beatitude of his that we talk about. So that comes after we do man. So for those of you who are in our Bible, our chronological Bible, we're on page 1113. We're on the second column of that page, just below the little box that talks about food and drink. Right? So that's, I read that at lunchtime, food and drink. Today's not going to be as much fun because we had poor meeting during lunch, right? And Jeannie Borowski told me to bring my own lunch. And I said to her, and when am I going to find time to bring my own lunch this Sunday? So I might have to read this again and again during this day so that I feel better. All right. So we're going to pick up in Matthew, the 5th chapter. 17th verse, all right? For those of you who are not in our Bible, Matthew 5:17. Well, I think we read that last week, didn't we? We ended that last week, didn't we? Okay, so let's then go to verse 21, all right? You have heard it said to those of old, you shall not murder, and whoever murders will be in danger of the judgment. But I say to you that whoever is angry and with his brother without a cause shall be in danger of the judgment. And whoever says to his brother, Rakah, shall be in danger of the council. But whoever says, you fool, shall be in danger of hellfire. Therefore, if you bring your gift to the altar and there remember that your brother has something against you, leave your gift there before the altar and go your way. First be reconciled to your brother, and then come and offer your gift. Agree with your adversary quickly while you are in the way with him, lest your adversary deliver you to the judge. The judge hand you over to the officer, and you be thrown into prison. Assuredly, I say to you, you will by no means get out of there till you have paid the last penny. So he begins with a command, right? Simple commandment, and says, we all understand the command, right? So as all good followers of God, all Jews would have known, right? That is a commandment of God not to what? Murder. Okay. Now we can have our own debates at another time, or maybe you can ask our stand-in teacher after I leave if you want to debate this more, what murder means, right? Because today we've done the same thing that the Pharisees did, And that is that we've put so many definitions upon it, right? That we don't necessarily get right back to what the commandment told us in the beginning, right? Yeah, so we can have this whole debate, right? Some other time, maybe, if, you know, if we want to sound like a, this really crazy Sunday school class, we can have a whole hour on murder. How about that sound, right? We could put it on a billboard. Come talk, come join us for a murder class. We might get a lot of people, right? Right? It'd be a real opportunity to witness, wouldn't it? Okay. So Jesus says, there is way more to this saying, right? I'm not taking away from this saying. Let's keep in mind what he's already said to the Pharisees and his disciples. I didn't come to change the law, but to become it, right? And so what is he saying here? He says, if you want to use that as your benchmark, thou shalt not murder, right? I'm going to set a new benchmark for you, right? He's not changing that commandment, but he's saying, if you look in context of that commandment, right, I'm going to set a higher benchmark for you that is representative of, okay, the grace, the love, and the mercy of God. Isn't it? Isn't that what his benchmark is about? It is not about murder or non-murder. It is about how we look at other people beyond that. It's a new benchmark, is what I would call a new benchmark. And what does that benchmark say? It says first. Whoever of you is angry with his brother without a cause shall be in danger of judgment. Okay? Now, there's a good legal term in there, right, Mr. Andreessen? Right? Without a cause, right? I make sure that all my contracts say, right, you can only sue me if there's a cause, right? And then I put in really, really small print, if I can get away with it, I get to determine the cause. And always work. Right. Right. So, without a cause, it says that it doesn't say here you can't get angry with your brother, does it? No. And my sister's claim, it has nothing to do with them at all. Right? It's only my brother. Right. Now, my brother was so much younger than me that we never got angry with each other. It really worked out well. Right? So you can't get angry with your brother without a cause, it says, right? So does that mean that you don't get angry at all? No, it means that sometimes there are justifications for you getting angry, but he's going to go on and tell us how we resolve that anger, correct? You can't stay angry. Yeah. Well, sometimes we forget that, Joyce. You know, we forget that. I don't know how many times that we, even in this class, people go, can we stop studying the Old Testament? I'm so tired of people getting zapped and hammered and God being ruthless. And, you know, and I keep, because I want to go to the New Testament where Jesus loves everybody. And, you know, but the reality is there are times when Jesus got angry, right? That's correct. There was a cause. There was a cause, right? So you can get angry, right? Without being, Jesus says, without being in threat of judgment, right? If there's a cause. But then he goes on to say, now let's talk about the causes and how do we deal with that, right? You can be angry, but it can't last forever, right? He says, if you come to the altar with your gift, right? So he's talking to the Jewish people about what is their sacrifice that they make at the temple, right? They bring their sacrifice to the temple. He says to them, your sacrifice means nothing, nothing, if you come to the altar holding a grudge against your brother. Because then what is it really? It's hypocrisy, isn't it? Right? That's kind of where we get caught as Christians today, isn't it? Non-believers look at us and go, you're just a bunch of hypocrites. Right? You talk about God's love and mercy, and what do you want to do? Right? You drive right by me when I'm on the street. Or you don't, you just let me be locked up in prison and don't ever come and talk to me, right? Or whatever the case may be. Right? And they look at us and go, you're just hypocrites. This is what Jesus is saying of those people going to the temple. He says, if you go to the temple and you're angry with your brother and you make a sacrifice to God for all that you have, what are you? You're a hypocrite, right? So what do you do first? You go and reconcile with your brother, and then you come to the altar with what? Pure heart, right? Now, how easy is that? Anybody here think that that's just the easiest thing in the world to do? Yeah, same, but isn't that the same thing? That's what you're cleaning out, aren't you, Lisa? Right? So Lisa says, you got to go ask for forgiveness, right? Because then you're coming to ask God for forgiveness, right? We have that parable, don't we? Right? Jesus teaches that parable where the guy is forgiven his debt, and then he turns right around into his debtor and does what? Throws him in prison forever, right? Right? It does. So Lisa says it requires a change of attitude about yourself, which in fact it does. When we go to the altar, when we go to worship, right? The thing that we have to always think about is Jesus is saying to us, when you come to worship God, right? What should be first and foremost in your thought process? God. Right? And how can you get there? How can you get there if you're holding all of that other stuff? Right? Okay? So he says, where am I? Therefore, you bring your gift to the altar. Remember that your brother has something against you. Leave the altar. Go reconcile it. Come on. Agree with your adversary quickly.
All right.
Yeah. How many is that? How much is that easy? Okay. Right. So, Virginia Fleming, are you on the phone? Are you on the line?
Yes, so, I am.
Okay, so let me ask you a question, Virginia. When you're arguing with your 5-year-old granddaughter, how easy is it to get over quickly? You're not answering, are you?
No, because it doesn't. She's only 5, so it's pretty easy.
It is not for me. She just keeps bringing it back.
I know.
I can't get her to agree. Okay, it's done. Let's forget about this, right? She's just like her mother. It just keeps coming back. She's just like her grandmother. It just keeps coming back and back and back.
Wait, which grandmother?
He just grand Nana. Right, it's Nana. And okay. she's not here, I can say that. It's not easy. It's not easy to look at your adversary and say, let's resolve this, right? And what I found for me is the only way that I can do that is just to go, you know what? Let's just agree we don't agree.
Yeah.
Because otherwise we're just going to... I mean, with her, it's different, right? I can finally say, go to your room. So, but I can't with people that I disagree with. And we face those things all the time, don't we? Yeah, I've noticed that. Okay. So Jesus says to them, Get that over with, because what happens if you don't? You're not going to be able to focus, right? How can we come to the altar? How can we focus on what Christ tells us or God tells us when we're just ate up with discontent, argument, whatever? Right? And that doesn't mean it doesn't happen. It happens every day, right? There are plenty of things we don't agree with, right? Wouldn't it be nice if you could just go through the world and everybody agreed with everybody, right? It'd probably be pretty stable. I mean, I can't even imagine what it would be like if everybody that sat in the House of Representatives or the Senate agreed with each other. I'm not sure we could take it as a country. We'd probably just fall apart. Anyway, it's difficult, right? So we need that, but we need to understand what Jesus told us to do. I don't know. I was not a good teacher. I didn't prepare Lisa to look that up. Says what? Oh, really? So it's another word for fool. Okay. Whoever calls his brother a fool. Okay. So that must have been, though, something that would get you in trouble with the leadership, if you use that word, Lisa, because it says with the council, right? And then it says, you fool shall be in danger of hellfire. Right.
That's not what he said. Is that I said, if you met this part of your dad, it doesn't matter the things that you say as much as the part that you say them.
Okay. So for you, for everyone at home, right? Lisa said, what you want to make sure of, it's not necessarily name calling there. It's what's in your heart that's going to get you in trouble. It's what Jesus says, right? Right? The name calling goes along with that, but, you know, you have to have it in your heart. It's not in your heart. So, Lisa, I don't know. I can look that up, but check. But that sounds reasonable to me. All right. Okay. So let's move on. Are we okay with murdering people now? No? Not good. I'm glad we're not. Okay. Let's move on to verse 27. You've heard that it was said to those of old. Jesus is saying, now you know what the commandments are. You shall not commit adultery. But I say to you that whoever looks at a woman to lust for her has already committed adultery with her in his heart. Jimmy Carter lived these verses, right? Admitted to them in the White House. That was pretty bold for him to say that. All right. If your right eye causes you to sin, pluck it out and cast it from you, for it is more profitable for you than that one of your members perish than your whole body to be cast into hell. And if your right hand causes you to sin, cut it off and cast it from you, for it is more profitable for you that one of your members perish than for your whole body to be cast into hell. Right. So again, Jesus is not saying this commandment has changed. He's setting a new standard, right? And here's his new standard, right? His new standard was, even if you think, right? Even if you think, it's the same sin as if you do. Right? Okay. Now, interesting enough, in these next two verses, right, or these next couple of verses, right, the penalty, those actually have been turned into penalties, right? Those are, if under Sharia law, right, you steal something, what happens to you? Your hand's cut off so that you can't steal again, right? Now, I don't know about plucking your eyes, but regardless, the... So,
question.
Yes.
Question. And is Sharia law based on the Quran? Does it say
yes.
That?
I don't know. I haven't read it this week.
Okay.
But I have a copy, Virginia, and I'll be glad to share it with you and you can look it up.
Okay.
Okay. I would guess not, and that it is very much the same as what we're reading here in scripture, that there is, that the angel Gabriel came to Muhammad and said, there are these things that we should do in life, but they were not written as law, and that man has taken the scripture, has taken that message to Muhammad and turned it into law, right? Just as the Pharisees did with the Ten Commandments and beyond, right? Right? I mean, just once again, we probably cannot survive if we only looked at, had 10 laws in this country, right? Because nowhere in it, nowhere in there does it say you can't drag race down Barber Cypress, right? So, you know, we need laws. It is to the extent that we use them and we manipulate God's law that we get ourselves in trouble. Okay, so he says, and it is for us a new standard. It is a new image that he puts in our mind that says, if you're going to do something like that, right, you'd be better off cutting out the piece that causes you to do that than losing your whole life. So that's what he's saying to us, right? Okay, so how easy is it for us to lose our life? We're very fortunate, correct? We're very fortunate because another couple of chapters along, Christ is going to hang on a cross though, so that we can. Right?
That's just a thing of the fact about itself, that we all have responsibility. It's not just a few of us. We all have something in our life, lots of anger other people. We all hate each other from time to time. And the point is that the focus needs to be turning ourselves over to recognizing what we did, not trying to achieve some sort of false and
righteousness. Exactly. Right. So Lisa says it's the whole message is about where we're supposed to be in our life and what God wants to do in our life and what God wants our life to be like. Right. You know, in my message this morning, think about it. Right. There is, we are who we are. Right. We're human beings. We do things we shouldn't do, we think things we shouldn't think. And the reality is, if we will listen to the Holy Spirit, it will guide us away from those things. So it is the Holy Spirit then really that does that amputation for you. Thank you. Really? That's interesting.
Next step, which turns into
right. Okay. I mean, I could see that, although I can differentiate one sin from another. That's my struggle.
Yeah.
That I don't know. Okay. Okay. Let's keep going. Verse 31. Furthermore, it has been said, whoever divorces his wife, let him give her a certificate of divorce. But I say to you that whoever divorces his wife for any reason except sexual immorality causes her to commit adultery. And whoever marries a woman who's divorced commits adultery. All right. So now, I'm not going there. We can have another whole hour class on that, right? I'm not going there, but I will tell you this, right? I'll just give you a point of context from my life, right? I've been married 44 years. At about 25, we sat down one night and agreed that it'd be a lot easier to live together and hate each other than it would be to get divorced. Not that we hated each other, but it would just be a lot easier to do that. So now I know that I can make 50, because we've already agreed we're going to make 50. So it, you know, we need to think about, and really what Christ is saying to us is, let's think about where we are. God calls us into a union if we make that decision to be in that union, right? God works for us to stay in that union, right? You want to come talk to me individually? I'd be glad to talk to you. There are times when divorce is a solution. I'm never going to say there's not. There are times when it is. So I would never say anything about that. And I'm not going into creating adultery and doing all of those other, I'm not going to go there, but we can if you want later. Vicki. Yeah, I remember you and I talking about that story. That's, you know. Okay. All right. We got 50 more minutes, and I'm turning over to my secret teacher. All right, here we go. Verse 33. Again, you have heard it said, and to those of old, you shall not swear falsely, but shall perform your oaths to the Lord. But I say to you, do not swear at all, neither by heaven, for it is God's throne, nor by earth, for it is his footstool, not by Jerusalem, for it is the city of the great king. Nor shall you swear by your head, because you cannot make one hair white or black. I've tried to make mine black, it just doesn't work. But let your yes be yes, and your no, no, for whatever is more than these is from the evil one. All right, so let's go back to the Ten Commandments. Thou shalt not use the Lord's name in vain, right? So probably one of the things that bothers me most in where we are in the world. And there are a lot of things that bother me about where we are. But the fact that we have just let language go so far into the toilet that I don't think we'll ever get out of it. And it's become acceptable. It's not that people use it and other people go, gosh, it shouldn't be that way. It's become acceptable, right? It's on television. It's in the news. It's in the press conferences. It's our public representatives who use that language. Oh, it's terrible. I just struggle personally. I really struggle. Christ says what? Stand up for what you think. Right? If you believe it, say you believe it. Don't wash around it. Just say yes or no. And think about how you use the Lord's name. And think about where you swear an oath. Right? I mean, it was well known in Old Testament history that people swore oaths, right? That's how they accounted for what they were going to do. They swore oaths. Look at the parameters and put the new standard that Jesus creates here. Right? You shall not swear falsely, right? But perform your oath to God. Who are you going to swear an oath to? You only need to swear an oath to God. That's who it's to, right? But then he gives us all the parameters of how not to swear our oath. To heaven, to the throne, to Jerusalem, to God, right? Just say yes, that's what I believe. Say no, that's not what I believe. Right? I don't see anything negative in it or that makes me feel bad about saying yes or no. If we are saying what we truly believe based on where we are reconciled with our God, Do I need to swear by that God that that is what it is? He knows what's in your heart. And if you've got someone that doesn't believe you or isn't going to agree with you, then let's go back to where we just read. And let's all agree that we're not going to agree. All right. 38. This is my, this is one of my favorite parts of Matthew's commandments. Because it speaks to where we need to be. It's really, maybe I ought to use this as the lesson for our core meeting today, right? Getting up in 38. You have heard it said, an eye for an eye and a tooth for a tooth. I tell you not to resist an evil person, but whoever slaps you on your right cheek, turn the other to him also. If anyone wants to sue you and take away your tunic, let him have your cloak also. And whoever compels you to go 1 mile, go with him too. Give to him who asks you, and from him who wants to borrow from you, do not turn away. All right, so let's think about that for a moment. Right? So we think of that in terms of retribution, but in fact, what was a slap in the face? Anyone? Right? It was an insult, right? And so if someone insults you, what do you do? Instead of insulting them back, right? Just let it go, right? Is that easy to do? Huh? You know, that I'm sitting on this stool today thinking, man, I got to go home and do some work. There are a lot of things here that I've been commanded in these scriptures that I have to think about. Right? It's not easy to do that. Right? I mean, it hurts, doesn't it, when somebody insults you? Even sometimes, even when it's not intentional, we get insulted when it's not intentional. Well, that even hurts worse. Just let it go, Jesus says. Let it slide off. Turn the other cheek. Accept it and move on, right? If anyone wants to sue you and take away your tunic, right? So that's it. That's interesting because some, I think, someone have an NIV. I don't believe the NIV says sue you. It says if someone wants to take your tunic, as if they're stealing your tunic, right? That's not the message that we read in the King James Version here, the New King James, or the NRSV. It is if someone sues you and takes away, you know, they sue you and take your coat, what do? Give it to them, right? It's done. It's not stealing. So it's not saying to us, if someone steals your coat, run down the street and hand them your jacket too, right? That's not what it's saying, right? Okay. And if someone says, go with me 1 mile, what do? Go two. That is the piece of this message to me that is where Christians stand out. Right? Think about it. We just talked about this morning. Someone's in need. They need meals. They need whatever. What is this class really good at? Going that extra mile. Making sure that if they need a meal once a month, that we are ready to provide them a meal every week. If they need a meal every week, that we're ready to provide them a meal every day. Right? That's where this class goes the second mile, in that we don't just look across the parking lot at Mesa Outreach and go, isn't it great that they help all these people in the community? We make sure that the pantry's full. That's Christ calling us to go another mile. Because the first mile is, well, let me just make sure that, you know, once a month I get peanut butter. The second mile is when Amber Woodman says, we're running out of food. She doesn't even have to ask. All she has to say is, we're running out of food in this class. Make sure that the pantry is full. That's the second mile. That's where we're called to be, right? Yes, ma'am.
Well, just as a thank you. Janet told me in the beginning of the year, which tallied up last year, our class was the biggest contributor to the whole church. I can't compare it to other churches. Our church, we were the largest and most consistent.
Oh, There's no doubt in my mind, right? Because everybody in this class, they're filled with that understanding of what Christ calls us to be, right? To do that, to go the second mile, to give to the person that asks you, right? That's his next line. And not into the person that wants to borrow some from you, right? Don't turn away. So my good example of that is I have one of those neighbors that borrows everything, right? He doesn't bring it back. I love the guy. He's a great guy, right? Great neighbor. So there are times when he wants to borrow things, and I keep going, I'm probably going to need that next month. I don't really want to give it to him because I'm not going to get it back until it's time. But I give it to him. So that's what we're called to be. Right?
Ever. I think that extra mile is also the bad people approach us on the street.
I do too, Amber. So, no, I mean, so Amber says that extra mile is also carrying a bag of food in your car or coupon to meals or whatever there may be. And what I would say to that is this, right? Some people struggle with that. Some people don't. There are times when you hand that bag out. I was at a stoplight a month ago. There's a lady that lives on the corner, right? Someone had apparently given her a bag of food that she didn't like what was in it. So she came running out in traffic and threw it back into the car that came from, you know, and I'm thinking, you know, so that's why we struggle with that. We all have to go back to what George said that time we were, I'll never forget, the time that the lady came to our class and with her story of she needed money and whatever, and she did it at the first class, and we were very supportive of her, and she had this first camp. And I knew that, but I didn't say it. And George says afterwards, you know, let her do what she wants to do. God called us to be giving people. We gave. That's what we're called. So we struggle with that. At least I struggle with that. Sure, exactly. Right? We weren't called to judge her because of what she did. She did what she did. As George said, we were called to forgive her because that's what God wants. So, all right, let's finish up with, we're going to finish up with Matthew, and then next week we'll talk about Luke's woes. Picking up in 43. You've heard it said, you shall love your neighbor and hate your enemy. I don't remember it saying that, but that's what he says. And hate your enemy. But I say to you, love your enemies, bless those who curse you, do good to those who hate you, and pray for those who spiritually use you and persecute you, that you may be sons of your Father in heaven, for he makes his sun rise on the evil and on the good, sends rain on the just and the unjust. For if you love those who love you, what reward have you? Do not even the tax collectors do the same? And if you greet your brethren only, what do you do more than others? Do not even the tax collectors do so? Therefore, you shall be perfect just as your Father in heaven is perfect. Right? What's his message? Right? Let's set the new standard. The new standard is we're called to love everybody. However difficult that is, right? That isn't easy, is it? Right? Right? It's not easy, right? But remember this, we're all created by the same God. That's where it gets difficult, isn't it? We want to start to differentiate. We want to start to say, well, you don't believe the way I believe, right? Right? I mean, just look at the conflict in Israel. Right? Why is that conflict? Oh, yeah, because we don't believe the same way, right? That's putting it very, very simply, isn't it? There's way more to that conflict than we just don't believe the same way. But very simplistically, right? As I would say to debates that I've had with individuals that I know who are Muslim, right? Let's go back to Abraham, was Abraham the father of your monotheistic religion? And they would say, yes. And I said, oh, isn't that interesting? He's mine too. Right? We're all created by the same God. Unfortunately, each of us is created with our own mind, our own ability to make decisions, right? Our own thought processes. And when we have those, then sometimes we do things that don't, where we don't get along, right? And we become enemies. Right? So at the root, God says what? I came to love the world. Right? Through my grace, I allow you to love everyone. And through my mercy, you are loved, right? Regardless of who you are, what you do, what you believe, you are loved, right? And Christ sets the new standard and says, we're called to be the same. Does that mean we don't have enemies? Does that mean we disagree? I mean, that we agree with everything that everybody believes and does? No, it does not mean that at all, right? It means that we have to look on each and every individual as a human being created in the image of God, right? That has the ability to make their own choices. And sometimes we don't agree with the choices we make, right? All right? That's pretty evident. That's pretty evident in the world today. The world is white. The world is full of very narrow-mindedness. That doesn't mean that it's right or wrong. It just means that it's there. We're called to be a step above that. The new standard says we have to step above that. We have to remember that God's filled our heart with love, mercy, and grace. It's through that it's who we are, that we should look at other people the same way, right? What did Jesus say? What are the two greatest commandments? And what? Yeah, your neighbor as yourself. And then he goes on to say what? Right? He kind of adds the third caveat. And treat people the way you want to be treated. Right? Isn't that exactly what all of these commands are about? Those three things. All right. Okay. Next week, we'll pick up with Luke. We'll talk about the woes from Luke, which is Luke taking his four Beatitudes. He's going to invert them and say, if you're blessed because you're a poor, right? And that's what Luke says, then you're not blessed because you're wealthy. That's what it's going to be. We're going to look at that and talk about why that gets taken out of context and what it does when we take it out of context and what Luke's intent was in saying that. So we'll look at those next week. With that, I'm going to turn it over to our special guest today to talk about the Beatitudes. Lisa Andreessen is going to come and talk about, she's going to help us with Greek and Hebrew and all those good things. And she has a PowerPoint presentation here that she's going to go through. Thank you. All right. Thank you, everybody. Have a good week. All right. And I'll see some of you at core meeting. And I'll see some of you in worship at worship. No, I haven't. You can set those tests. See right here. If you want to sit on the stool since you're taller, and do that. See? Okay. All right. Can everybody see her at home? Is that better? Okay. All right.
You all know me, and it's been a while since I've taught this class, but when Ron said, you know, he's going to have to leave early, and he gave me an opportunity to just bring a few ideas to you about the Beatitudes. A couple of years ago, Millard had asked me to teach his class, which is also Ron's wife's class, and the topic was the Sermon on the Mount. So I did a lot of studying. Because it's so familiar to us, you know, and I know this time going through it again, and Ron has been emphasizing the differences in the gospel accounts, just in general, as we're going through the teachings of Jesus. So guys think that is with you, but one of the differences that we've noticed immediately in looking at the Beatitudes, so-called, which is part of the Sermon on the Mount. The Beatitudes are actually what occurs in Matthew 5, verses 3 through about 10 or 11. And so if you want to go back to that, you can look at it. We were a little bit ahead in Matthew. As you know from Ron, Luke really doesn't spend a lot of time on that same part of Jesus's teaching. So it's Matthew who does the most with that. And so I thought that I would go back with you to Matthew's gospel and just give you a little bit of introduction again about who Matthew was and what his goal was. And then remind you too that I was for many years a teacher of literature and language. So as we all have our own focuses and predilections, mine has always been on close analysis of text. We can do this with Matthew and the other gospel writers because it is actually literature that's written down. And if you remember the times that I've taught the class before, you know, we've talked about the fact that we're reading it in another language, and so that puts up a barrier. And I've encouraged all of you to read as many translations of what you're reading as you can. When we're reading Matthew's gospel, we're actually reading, most of us are reading a translation of the New Testament Greek. So, but it is possible to do language analysis, literary analysis, let's say, of gospel writing too. And we know from all of you know this already, that Matthew was actually a Jew, and so he was familiar with the Old Testament. He would have been familiar with the Hebrew scriptures. And his focus, when you do literature analysis, one of the questions you have to ask yourself is about the writer, who he is or she, you know, what their background is, everything that you know about them. The other question you ask is about the audience. And we've talked about this, that Matthew was a Jew and Matthew was familiar with the Hebrew scriptures, and that Matthew's audience, what he was primarily, who he was primarily writing to at the time, were the Jews. And his two focuses, really, one is to show that Jesus Christ is actually the Davidic Messiah. So he starts the whole of his gospel off with the genealogy. That would have been very important to Jewish readers, to put Jesus in that line of David. And that, so the Messiah is his first focus. And then the second one is to communicate the nature of the kingdom, the messianic kingdom, the Messiah's kingdom. Because as we know from our long study of the Old Testament, kingdom was a term for the Jews that meant a physical place, you know, and it was power. And it was David and Solomon and all of the kings. So Matthew, though, needs to communicate the nature of this new kind of kingdom, which is called in Matthew, or by Matthew, the kingdom of heaven. Interestingly enough, in most of the other gospels, you read kingdom of God. But in Matthew, you have kingdom of heaven over and over again. And I think part of this is because, again, he's trying to move the Jewish audience away from this very prejudicial view they have of what a kingdom is. So he starts his whole gospel with the genealogy to make sure that he's presenting Jesus as the son of David and the true Messiah. And then he moves into the nature of the kingdom. So by chapter 3, you already have him quoting John the Baptist saying, "Repent, for the kingdom is at hand." And this is in Matthew 3, verse 2. "Repent, for the kingdom of heaven is at hand." And our first encounter with the kingdom concept in Matthew is at that point. And he begins the gospel then and moves into the teachings of Jesus from that standpoint. Now, we know the word repent, and we've seen that repentance is by no means absent from the Old Testament. Repentance is all over the Old Testament. Over 1,000 times, the concept is brought up, but there's really no Hebrew one word for repent or repentance. There's several words. And the words, one of them, the root of it is shub. And what it means is to turn back, turn around, or return. Think about how many times in the Old Testament we heard God say, return to me and I will return to you. And so the concept in the Hebrew, that so in Matthew's mind and in the Jewish mind for repentance is that it's to turn back to God, even turn physically around and go in another direction. So that's only important to know because the word, there is a word for repentance in the Greek New Testament, and Matthew uses it, and so do the other gospel writers. And the word is metanoeo. I don't think when I did this lesson before, I had lots more slides, but Ron told me, you're going to have about 10 minutes. I tried to tear it down, but metanoeo is made up of two words. Meta is to change or different, and noeo is to think. And so the Greek repentance, the repentance word that gets used in the New Testament over 100 times, means to change your thinking. So if you're with me on this wavelength here, everything we heard this morning goes right along with that, because Matthew continues to insist upon this idea of attitude and thoughts. What's inside of you is what needs to be changed, turned around. Think differently, think another way. And as I said, that we're going to continue to see that in Matthew, I think, with the attitude and thinking, because his kingdom of heaven, his kingdom that the real Messiah is bringing in, is one more of spirit than it is of the physical. And you saw when we read before that Luke actually leaves out that in spirit from his first beatitude. So I'm going to try to move now to my slides so we can talk about the actual beatitudes. By the way, the beatitude is a word that was not ever in the scripture. This is something that an editor added later, and it means though state of being blessed. So it's a state of being that Matthew is describing here with these beatitudes, and they are progressive. They start at one end and end at another. So I call them the principles of the kingdom of heaven. And if you'll notice as we're going along, they may remind you of some other principles that go along with certain 12-step programs that are designed to help you change your attitude, change your way of thinking about things. And they fit right in with that. So the first one, as we know, is blessed are the poor in spirit, says Matthew, not Luke. For theirs is the kingdom of heaven. And we've already said that, you know, Luke seems to have much more of a focus on the social scene. Remember, he is not a Jew, and his audience is much wider. Matthew is preaching at the Jews, who would have needed, he thought, a deeper sense of what poor in spirit means. So Matthew's version is actually very clear. Jesus is announcing the first and fundamental requirement for receiving the blessing of life in the kingdom, in this new kingdom. And what is it? It's a deep sense of one's own spiritual poverty and need for God. I put some, I don't know if you can even see on that, but there's some other translations that help with this. The NIV says what I just read, but the Message says you're blessed when you're at the end of your rope. With less of you, there is more of God and his rule. How happy are the humble-minded, for the kingdom of heaven is theirs. And the word here for poor in the Greek is tokos, which means just shriveled up, bent over, and destitute, completely lacking in resources. Not necessarily monetary, but in every way. Think it at the end of your rope again. And so the first step then, the first principle of the kingdom of heaven for Matthew is what could also be called the first step in repentance, because it's my belief that the Beatitudes do not only give you means for blessing, it's the blessing that comes as a result of your repentance. And step one is deep sense of my own helplessness. I can't do this on my own. I admit that I have no power over you, fill in the blank. And that's a different kind of poor than we've heard from Luke. Principle two, I have to go on because I'm going to run out of time. Blessed are those who mourn, for they will be comforted. So if you buy into this idea that I have, that what we're getting from Matthew here is how to live in this new kind of kingdom, how to be blessed in it, then these are steps to get there. And we know from our own Christian experience that this is not a one-time deal. This is a daily deal. This is a steps in a process that does lead somewhere. So in the NIV says, blessed are those who mourn, for they will be comforted. Here's another one from the Message. The translation is, you're blessed when you feel you've lost what is most dear to you. Then you can be embraced by the one most dear to you. And the word for mourning here, pentheo, means to mourn the loss of someone or something. But it also can mean to feel guilt. So if you're thinking about repentance here, the idea of mourning for your own guiltiness, your own sins, which is not necessarily talking about someone you've lost, it's talking about your loss of God's presence, right? And the comfort word, and we had this today because Ron did a whole sermon on the Holy Spirit and what the Holy Spirit does for us. Well, in Greek, the word that's used for comforted is parakaleo. And parakaleo comes from para, which means right up next to or right up beside, and kaleo, which means to call or summon or to encourage and comfort. And this is the word in a noun form that Jesus uses in John to call the Holy Spirit. It's, you've heard it in other, like in the New, the King James often says the paraclete. That's a direct thing from the Greek there. It's the, what comes right up next to you and encourages, calls to you and moves you, you know, comforts you, gives you encouragement. Oh, I also mention here that the kaleo, or part of that, is sometimes used in court to mean an advocate, someone who stands up for you, like an attorney. And we know that too from the power of the Holy Spirit, that Jesus is also our paraclete and also stands up to speak for us. So step two in how to live in the kingdom, the new kingdom for Matthew, and step two for the process of repentance is to confess guilt and regret sin when you mourn the loss of your connection to God and you are sorry for your sins. I hope I can push the right one. It's okay. Yes. Okay. This is my favorite one because blessed are the meek. This used to just drive me crazy because nobody likes the word meek. Everybody thinks of meek as has the worst connotations possible in the English language right now. So that there are lots of other translations, but it's lost what it originally meant. And it actually was only used in English from the 12th century onward. So that's pretty late, you know. We think of meek as weak, but what the Greek meant, which is praus, is gentle, mild, a blend of gentleness and strength, like self-control. And what is even closer is I give up my control so that God can control me. So think of meekness as another way of emptying myself of myself so that God is in control. And that leads to self-control. And this is the kind of gentleness that Matthew is quoting Jesus as saying. The other interesting thing about this is that what the reward here is that they will inherit the earth. And you know from all our studies of the Old Testament, how important was it to the Jews to have land, right? It still is. Inheriting the earth was significant. But the only way to that is to give up your own control and allow God to control. And that's true meekness. So in the steps of repentance, this is the, I accept the things that I can't change. This is allow God to control what you do and your life. I'm going backwards. Okay. Principle 4, or the next beatitude, is blessed are those who hunger and thirst for righteousness, for they shall be filled. And here I just want to say one thing. Notice that he does not say, blessed are the righteous, which he does say, blessed are the merciful. This is significant because none of us is righteous in our own selves. All of us are righteous only because of the righteousness of God. So what we need is a hunger and seek the true source of it, which is God. The word that, here's some other translations. I think I may have just put one here. God blesses those people who want to obey him more than to eat and drink. They will be given what they want. And if you think about this, you know, for me, food and drink is often a comfort thing. And it can get, I can get caught up in using that as a comfort rather than a thirst for God. It's so easy. I mean, we all do that, and there's nothing really wrong with that. We're human beings. But principle of the kingdom is to crave God's approval. And the approval part comes from this, I'm skipping over the Greek here, pineo means to not just be hungry. It means to be ravenous. And then this other word, dikaiosune, this is the righteousness word. And it comes back in later, you know, the righteousness is all over Matthew. But the word itself means judicial approval, and it's really a word from the court. DK is a judicial verdict. It's the most common word for righteousness in the New Testament. So, but think of the court as God's court. So it's what's right, what's deemed right and righteous by God only, not by man, but it's God's righteousness. So if we move along in the steps of repentance again, this is wishing to have God's approval rather than the approval of man or ourselves. And every one of these, as you can see, it's taking you out of yourself. It is diminishing the self and manifesting God, essentially. Same thing with the 12-step programs. You know, you have to get rid of your own ego in order to be able to move forward. Next one is, blessed are the merciful, for they will be shown mercy. Another translation from the Message of that is, you're blessed when you care. And that puts a little bit of a different spin for me on merciful. At the moment of being careful, you yourselves are cared for. And the word for merciful here is a word that you're familiar with, even if you don't know Greek, because you hear it all the time. It's the word that's in eleison, kyrie eleison. If you've been in choir, if you've ever heard any music, you know that from a mass and you hear the Greek, that's the word. The root is eleimon, and it does mean mercy, Lord have mercy. Eleos, though, is connected also to a Hebrew word, hesed, in the Old Testament. And what's interesting about this is when I looked it up, This is a word for mercy in the Old Testament. It means this. It means covenant loyalty, covenant love, properly mercy as it is defined by loyalty to God's covenant. It puts it squarely again into God's court. So to be merciful is to be true to God's covenant, not just what you think is mercy, but back again into following God's laws for us. And so for me, that reminded me of step five in the repentance process, which is forgive as you are forgiven. It's impossible for us to be forgiven. And we had this today in the lesson that we were listening to. You know, if you have something in your heart against your brother, or you know your brother has something against you, you can't go for forgiveness from God. You've got to get rid of that first. So you have to forgive. You have to be willing to forgive in order to receive forgiveness. If you are willing to forgive, that puts you in a totally different frame of mind and attitude. And Jesus saying, this is the frame of mind you must be in to be in the kingdom, one of forgiveness, but not mercy in the sense of, well, I'm going to grant you mercy. I'm going to let you off because you have power. No, it's God's mercy working through you because you are not the one with power. Again. Okay. All right, but now we're at, blessed are the pure in heart, for they shall see God. This really used to bother me because I was preached to by my mother from day one that we are never pure in heart. It's impossible for me to be pure. But again, this is because I, as a kid, was thinking, you know, on my own behalf, you can't make yourself pure. Another translation of that is you're blessed when you get your inside world, your mind and your heart right. Then you can see God in the outside world. Happy are the utterly sincere, for they will see God. Well, this is the most interesting thing of all in this lesson. And that is that the word that's used in Greek there is katharos. And you know that word if you've ever been in any kind of therapy or anything, or you read Greek tragedy. That's the catharsis word, right? So what he's saying is those who are pure of heart because they have gone through catharsis, they have been cleansed. This is not something that resides in you, purity of heart. This is something you get to because of the process of repentance. Catharsis, if you don't know, is that outpouring of grief. Some people, say that it's a good cry. It's cleansing from the inside out. It's letting out all your grief and pain and sorrow. And so this made sense to me because in repentance, you do become pure, but only through this whole process that we've said of admitting that you are not in charge of pouring out, you know, your sins, of confession, of this is a cleansing fire of repentance. And in that sense, we are pure in heart. Blessed are the peacemakers, for they shall be called the children of God. There's a lot of political stuff that this makes you think of. It always makes me think of the UN when I hear this. But Matthew, of course, and Jesus are really not talking about anything political. The word that's used for peacemaker, the iropoios, which is from iro originally, which means to join together in wholeness. The kind of peace we're talking about here is where things that have been broken are put back together into some kind of wholeness. So it's blessed are those who can do this, who can bring people back together, bring parts of yourself back together into a wholeness with God. And peace is God's gift of wholeness, which we get from this process. It reminded me of 2 Corinthians 5:19, which says this, look at it. All this comes from God who settled the relationship between us and him and then called us to settle our relationships with each other. That reminds you of today's lesson too. God put the world square with himself through the Messiah, giving the world a fresh start by offering forgiveness of sins. And here we're called the children of God as a result. The word here is the same word that is used for, you know, it's any kind of children, including those who are legally adopted. And we will share in, so in this one sense, we share the same nature as our Father, but also we legally inherit all that belongs to him. So reconciliation is the next step, and if you're looking at it from the repentance standpoint. Then we get to principle 8. Blessed are those who are persecuted because of righteousness, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. And we actually come right back to the beginning with this kingdom of heaven thing. You're blessed when your commitment to God provokes persecution. You're even deeper into God's kingdom. The word, two words here. One is dioko, and that's the persecuted in Greek here is even worse than it sounds in English, because it was a word that was only used of hunting down wild animals. So this is a horrible kind of thing to have happen to you. But the righteousness word is the same word that's used earlier. As I said, it's a word from the court, and it means only what is deemed right by the Lord, by God. Not necessarily what is deemed right by the Pharisees and the whole code of conduct. Because again, Matthew was talking to a world, a Jewish world that had come to be, that had gone away from these principles, these basic principles, and had come to see righteousness as something that was inherent in them. If they followed the law, if they kept all the commandments, then inherent in them was their own righteousness. And that was exactly the opposite of what Jesus was trying to tell them. So what is approved in the eyes of God is the only kind of righteousness that Matthew allows for. Okay, I think I covered what I wanted to, and I know I've run out of time. And again, my only goal here was to maybe give you a deeper, richer insight into this one essential part of Jesus's teaching that we've looked at now from two different gospel writers, and maybe give you another way to think about it when you go back and read it again. Thank you for listening. Now, do we have prayer requests before we close? Okay. Yes, we said a number of them in the beginning of class. Anybody else want to bring up prayer requests? Yes. And Ron for his sermon's about to. Okay, so we had Virginia Fleming, continued healing. Elsie and Carol for continued healing and the surgery. Anyone else?
What day is Carol's surgery?
Tuesday.
Thank you.
Yes. Okay, Linda says she'll keep you updated on the surgery. Can I go on?
Yeah.
All right, you want to go to the Lord in prayer now? Okay. Father God, thank you so much for this class, for this opportunity to come together both online and in person. Thank you for our teacher, Ron, giving him wisdom and guidance as he's preaching today and in his pursuing of the ministry. We pray that you would make us more aware of your presence in our lives, listening to the Holy Spirit as we're going along and remembering to invite you into every situation that we get into. Lord, we thank you for all the blessings that you've given us. We thank you for the blessing of our friends and our family, for our very lives. Go with us now. Help us to keep you in our hearts and in our minds, and to make ourselves into the, well, We ask that you make us into the people that you called us to be. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.
Thanks, Lisa.
Thank you, Lisa.